Are we ready? The last time we started to talk about a special situation in unsteady heat conduction, we considered a ball in such a way that the dimension parallel to the two surfaces are very large and that the temperatures are uniform on the two surfaces and therefore also in planes within the ball. So that, but we will assume, and we have assumed, that the temperature depends not only on the location within the ball, but also on time. So we want to look at a heating up or cooling down process. And we have derived the following equation, which describes then the heat conduction process by making an energy balance on a small layer in the wall. dT over d tau, t is the temperature somewhere within the layer, equal to alpha, the thermal diffusivity, which we had discussed the last time also and given values for it for various materials, times d over dx of dt over dx. And I mentioned that rather than attempt a exact solution, analytic solution of this equation, which is quite difficult, we will try to get an approximate solution. And we do it in the way that instead of infinitely small increments of time, of temperature in time or in length, we consider finite increments. So for this purpose, we subdivide our layer with a certain thickness, let's say d, into a number of slabs. Now, the result of our calculation would be the more accurate the larger our number of slabs is. On the other hand, it takes more, the work is larger. If we make the number of slabs smaller, we can get to a solution faster, but it is more approximate. So one has to decide how far one wants to go. And we would make these of uniform thickness. The thickness would be delta x. And we number the slabs, let's say starting here from zero, or the planes dividing the slabs, zero, one, two, three, and so on. And one in between, somewhere in the interior would be n. Then this one here would have the number n minus 1, and this one here has the number n plus 1. And in this situation, we know that the temperature depends on the location, so would be now a function of the number, of the location, which we indicate by the number, but it is also a function of time. In order to be able to solve the situation, we have, of course, to know an initial condition. We would have to know the temperature variation at a certain time. And from this time on now, we would again count, make finite time steps, let's say 1 second or 2 seconds, and count these, 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. And some arbitrary step, time point would be k. So this would be now the distribution, not the initial one, but the distribution after a certain time. We will assume that we know this. This would be, and what this curve means is that we plot temperatures in a vertical direction starting from a certain baseline. So that the temperature, for instance, at this point here is the temperature at location n at the time k. So we would indicate this by writing T n k. Then at a later time, if the ball would heat up, then the temperature curve would have raised to another position, let's say to this position here. And this would be after one more time interval, so that would have the number k plus 1. So that, for instance, this temperature here, we would call temperature at the same location n, but at the time k plus 1. Or let's just pick out another value. This one here, for instance, would be the temperature at the location n minus 1, but at the time k. Okay, and now we try to express these expressions which we have here, these differentials, by these temperatures which we have here. Now, let's first look at the dT over d tau. This means change of temperature with time. Now, instead of an infinitely small time step, which would result in an infinitely small temperature increase, we go now here in our method to finite steps. So I will indicate this by saying that is approximately equal to a finite temperature step, delta T, divided by delta tau. Where I have here by the partial differential sign tells me that I have to vary the time only, but keep the location fixed. So I have to indicate this here somehow too. I will put a small tau as index here on. This means the temperature variation with time. Now let's see how we could write it using the nomenclature which we have introduced into our figure. The delta tau we will maintain. But we want to have a small temperature variation in time, keeping the location fixed. This, for instance, would represent something like this. This is two consecutive times a fixed location. So this delta T sub tau we can write as Tn k sub 1 minus Tn k. Delta means always a difference. Tn k plus 1 minus Tn k. Now, the next thing is then to express this here. So we want to find an approximate expression for dT over dx. Excuse me. Maybe we indicate again that this is then only approximately equal to delta T, again, a finite change in temperature, but now produced by a finite change in x over delta x, divided by delta x. Now, we could take this too, but we will see that it is more convenient to take this. We want to take now a step in location at the same time. So we would take, for instance, this. Now, let's see how would we indicate this point. That would be t at the location n plus 1 at the time k. So we would have t n plus 1 k minus this one here, t n k, divided by delta x. Yeah, but we need now this expression. Let's see how we can interpret this one here. D over dx of dt over dx. Now d, again in approximate way, would be replaced by delta. So we have to build the difference of two of these values. Now, one of this value is this one here, which we have. And we have, this is this difference. And we have to build another, let's say, subtract this from another difference, from a neighboring difference. For instance, this one here. So, we would have to write. T n plus 1 k minus T n k over dx minus T n k minus T n minus 1 k. This is now the delta of this here. And we have to divide it by delta x. And we can continue. This is equal to, first now, we could bring these two expressions to the same numerator, dx, and then we have to divide by dx once more. So we have to divide by dx squared. And then we have just this difference of these expressions on top. So we have T n plus 1 k. Then we have minus T n k minus T n k. So we have minus 2 T n k. And then we have minus minus this expression, which goes to 2 plus, excuse me, T n minus 1. And now we can go back. We have this expression here. We have the other derivative here. We can go back into our differential equation and replace the corresponding terms in the differential equation. We can now also, we will do the following, that we, instead of writing now for this term this expression, we will move the delta tau over to the other side of the equation. So we have on the left-hand side of the equation T n k plus 1 minus T n k is equal. And on the right-hand side, I have the alpha. I have moved over to the right-hand side the delta tau. And I will take this delta x square and put it on in front. And then I have this expression left. T n plus 1 k minus 2 T n k plus T n minus 1 k. And actually, if I would want to make a numerical calculation, I could already do this with this equation, because let's say I start at the time 0, k equals 0. And for k equals 0, of course, I have to know the temperature distribution in the solid body in order to calculate the development in time of the temperature field. So this means for any arbitrary point, let's say n, if I have made my subdivisions into layers, I know the Tnk, I know the Tn plus 1k, and I know the Tn minus 1k. So I know this here. Then in making the subdivisions, I have made a decision on the delta x. So I know the delta x square. The material which I use tells me what the alpha is. And of course, I can actually freely select still. So I make a decision to select the delta tau, whatever I want it to be. So then I know the right-hand side of the equation. And this means I know the Tnk also. That's the same value as over on the right-hand side. So I can now calculate the Tnk plus 1. This means the temperature, one temperature point for the next time interval, for the next time step. And I can do this now for each of the points, and in this way get a new curve. And this is really what one does essentially, let's say, but only on a very simple example, if one uses an electronic computer. A digital electronic computer always, one converts a differential equation into a finite difference equation, and then the operations which I have to perform are just additions, multiplications, divisions, so on. And in this way I can, since an electronic computer can perform this very rapidly, I can of course use a very large number of subdivisions, can make short time intervals, so that I get a fairly good answer. But I will show still, if one wants to do this, one can still simplify this. And I want to come back, say, to my statement that of course we can use the delta tau completely arbitrarily. We could use it at 1 second, 2 seconds, or whatever it is. Now, if I use then the delta tau in such a way that this expression is equal to 1/2, alpha delta tau divided by delta x squared equal 1/2, then I will see that my equation considerably simplifies. I have this here, T n k plus 1 minus T n k equal, and let me take these two together. This is T n plus 1 k plus T n minus 1 k divided by 2. And then I have minus 2 divided by 2 times tnk. And you see the tnk cancels out on both sides of the equation, so I get a very simple expression. Tnk plus 1 is equal to tn plus 1k minus tn minus 1k over 2. So this means the new temperature after this specific time interval, which I calculate from this equation here, at this point here, this new temperature is just the arithmetic mean between the two neighboring point temperatures here. And this would hold for any. Of course, here in the figure, this isn't true. I haven't selected the right time interval. So this, of course, simplifies the equation very much. Pardon? Yeah, thank you. Oh, yeah, in both. Thanks. Yes, of course. Here, this is plus. I can also do it now very simply graphically if I want to, and it would work in the following way. I'll just take part of the ball, for instance, these three lines, which are somewhere within the solid material, where this is delta x. And this is delta x also. However, I have chosen it, to be. Then I would have a temperature curve. Yeah, this would be again layer n, this would be layer n minus 1, this would be layer n plus 1. And I have a temperature curve, say something like this here. Then, Tn plus 1k, yeah, this is the curve, temperature curve at time k. This is the Tn plus 1k. The Tn minus 1k, which I need, is here. So, in order to get the arithmetic mean between these two values, all I have to do is to connect these two points by a straight line. Then this is the new point. This is now my Tn k plus 1. And of course, this I do for all for any other point, and I get points of my new temperature curve. Let's just do this as an example to see how it works. Let's say we would have a ball with the thickness. Now the first thing is to choose subdivisions. Let's say we make 5. Which in reality should of course be of equal width. I may not be able to draw it quite this way on the blackboard. Then I have to know the initial temperature in the ball, and let's take any kind of curve. Then this would be at the time tau equals 0, from where I count now my time. And then let's say at this time, at this moment, the temperature of the surface of the wall, of one surface of the wall, is suddenly raised, let's say to this point here. So this is really still the time T0. So my temperature curve is really this here, and then in the wall it continues on the surface. This point in the wall, it continues at this curve here. Then in order to make the, let's say to answer the problem, I have to know what happens on the other side of the wall too. There could be a sudden, either the temperature could be fixed here on the other side of the wall, could be some sudden variation or some gradual variation, or finally there could be the condition that this is very well insulated so that no heat flows out of this wall. What does this mean? According to Fourier's equation, we have the heat flux per unit area and unit time is given by minus k times dp over dx, let's say if x is the direction normal to the ball. Now, the k is a finite quantity determined by the material, so this means if the q is the heat flux is 0, dt dx is 0. This means the temperature must be constant. It must have a constant, must end in a constant line here, so as it is shown here. So then this is our condition on the other side. Now, we can start with our construction. Let's get a new temperature point for this. The temperature at the surface is this, the temperature on this side here is this, so we have to connect these two by, let's later take another color, by a straight line. And this gives one new point, namely the temperature here. Then in order to find the temperature here, we have to connect this point with this point by a straight line. That gives this point here. And so on. To find this, we have to connect this point with this point. Here, we have to connect this point with this point here. Now we can already draw our new temperature curve. This is a point of the temperature curve. This is a point of the temperature curve. So if I approximate the actual temperature curve by a series of broken lines, then this would be one, then I have to connect these two points. I have to connect these here, or I should have made this right, this point here. And then in order to fulfill the condition that the heat flux on this side is zero, I draw this, the rest as a horizontal line. And this broken line then approximates my new temperature curve. If I want to, of course, in reality, it would be a curved line, which I could draw through this point too. And I know the delta x. I know from the material the alpha. So from this equation, I can calculate the time interval. So if I find, for instance, the delta tau is 1.35 seconds, then this means at the time 1.35 seconds, this is now my new temperature curve. And I can now arbitrarily continue. From here on now, if the temperature would stay constant, this point would always be fixed. So obviously all the new temperature curve would have to go to this point. Obviously what I will do is I just draw them now in with freehand. maybe the next temperature curve would do something like this, and then it would gradually get up higher. And the steady state is, of course, reached when finally all of the wall has reached the temperature which is prescribed at one of the surfaces of the wall. I can also, if I, for instance, am not satisfied, I would like to know, well, what kind of error did I make? How accurate is my solution? There is a simple means. I know that the solution becomes better the larger my number of layers into which I break the wall up, so I make a new calculation with double the number of layers. And then I check how much is the difference. If I actually, let's say, if one does this on an electronic computer, this is what one does again. One makes it with some subdivision, gets an approximation, makes it with a double number of subdivisions, sees how close the second approximation is, and one can go on until one is satisfied. Okay. Maybe one other condition which is quite interesting is the following. If I would have this condition, I have again a slab with a temperature which is originally uniform. So again, the temperature would be plotted here in a normal direction. And I would do the following. I see that the surface temperature varies in a periodic way, going up and down continuously. I could now make the same design or calculation, numerical calculation. What I would find out is the following, that these temperature fluctuations penetrate into the interior of the wall, but as they penetrate, they decrease in amplitude. So if I would just draw the amplitude, let's say this would be the highest temperature, this would be the lowest temperature of the fluctuation. Then the corresponding highest and lowest temperatures inside of the solid wall would do something like this. So each point fluctuates, but the deeper one comes, the smaller the temperature fluctuation becomes. One example for this is, for instance, let's say where one could use this, is if one is interested to find out, well, we have in our weather a daily temperature fluctuation. How deep does this daily temperature fluctuation penetrate into the ground? It will be, of course, conducted into the ground. And in normal ground, if one makes a calculation, one finds that it penetrates approximately 0.8 meters, or let's say order of magnitude of 1 meter. In addition, we have also yearly fluctuations. The temperature fluctuates over a year, high being high in summer, being low in winter. So one can also consider this fluctuation and ask, how deep does this fluctuation penetrate? One finds that it penetrates approximately 15 meters. This means below this level, the temperature is practically uniform, whether one measures it in summer or whether one measures it in winter, it makes no difference. This is, of course, not identical to the depth with which frost enters the ground, because the average temperature is higher than the freezing temperature. And frost penetrates only to such a depth where this temperature fluctuation goes below the freezing temperature. For instance, one would say here, if this temperature, let's say in summer, we have 20, 25 degrees centigrade, something like this. In winter, we might have 10 degrees centigrade. So let's take a little bit less, minus 5 degrees centigrade. So then 0 degrees centigrade might be somewhere here. And the frost only up to here temperatures which are below the temperature of the freezing water. This, of course, would shift if we go towards the North Pole. In the higher, the lower the average yearly temperature, the deeper the frost limit. Another example which shows that this can sometimes be quite short is in our engines, which we have in our cars. We have the temperature, the cylinder, the walls of the cylinders are continuously exposed to a varying temperature. There is an explosion of the gasoline which we put in, which creates a high temperature. Then this gas is exhausted. New air, which is cold, is sucked in. So there is quite a temperature variation in the interior of the cylinder. If one calculates how deep does this penetrate, one finds that it penetrates approximately 2 millimeters. So since this temperature variation in the temperature fluctuation in the cylinder is so extremely fast, this means that the penetration becomes very small. Okay, and I think with this I would like to conclude now our discussion on heat conduction problems alone. I would just like to point out once more, I have mentioned it before, anybody who is interested in some specific problem can also always look up whether solutions to this specific situation are already available, and there is a pretty large collection by P. Schneider. Which is called Temperature Response. Charts. Published by John Wiley, New York. 1963. Yes? I assume it is in the engineering library. I'm pretty sure. So. Now. The conduction processes which we have discussed up to now apply mainly to the situation in solid bodies, in liquids and in gases sometimes, but not always for the following reason. If we have a gas in a container, or a fluid, could be liquid or gas in a container, and we create somehow temperature differences by having, for instance, one side here heated then the following thing happens, that the fluid in the neighborhood of this heated region will get to a higher temperature than the fluid further away. As it does so, if it is a normal fluid, it expands and it becomes lighter, and therefore what one calls free convection currents would set in. So there would be some kind of free convection current move around in this way. And this now, of course, constitutes an additional transport of heat. Heat which is conducted from the wall into the fluid is then picked up and is, so to speak, bodily with the fluid moved around. One calls now this transport, which is carried along with the fluid, heat transport by convection. Now that must not be always the case that this occurs. If we have a very viscous fluid, then there are conditions where these convection currents either become very small or under some conditions stop completely. So that for such a situation, or if the temperature differences are very small, if the dimensions are very small, all of this would cut this convection current down, and then one could use the solution, the conduction solution, also in such a fluid. There is, of course, one more situation in which even at arbitrarily high temperatures or arbitrarily large scales, the fluid would still remain at rest, namely if we have a container with two horizontal walls, and the upper wall would be kept at a higher temperature and the lower wall at a cooler temperature, because then the fluid which is heated, the fluid portions are up on top, and as we move down here through the fluid, the temperature gets lower. This means the lightest, with the least density fluid portions are up here, and as we go down, the density becomes larger, so there's no reason for any kind of convection. This would be completely stated. Here again, conduction would be the only process. But what we want to discuss now really is a situation where we have convection as well as conduction. So this will then concern heat transfer in fluids. In many cases, actually, we have not this situation, where the convection, the flow, is generated just by temperature differences alone. But we have a situation where by some blower or pump or by some artificial mean, we actually create artificially a flow. To distinguish between both, we call this here free convection or natural convection. And the other, if we generate the flow by a blower or pump, we call this forced convection. Now, in reality, of course, even if we have forced convection, as soon as we have temperature differences, there will also be free convection. For instance, if we would have a horizontal pipe, and we move by force, by a blower, a fluid in this direction through the pipe, but have a heat transfer situation in this way that the walls of the pipe are hotter than the fluid, so that heat is transferred from the walls of the pipe into the fluid, then we would have the following situation if I draw now the cross-section of the pipe. That the layers, fluid layers around the wall will be the hottest ones because they receive the heat from the wall at first, whereas in the center the fluid would be colder, and this means then there are free convection currents setting in these, the flow, so if the hotter parts would move up and the cold parts in the center would move down. So instead of having a straight flow through the tube, the flow would kind of spiral down in this direction. But if we, this is usually a fairly small effect, if we have any larger velocities with which we generate the forced flow, then this effect is usually negligible. And this actually, if we can neglect this superimposed free convection, then this situation we call forced convection. If we have this situation and if it has an appreciable effect, then we talk about superimposed free and forced convection. Now, what we want to look at first is forced convection, so where we can neglect this free convection situation. And then we find the following, that if we have this, then under normal circumstances, the flow is not influenced by heat transfer at all. This means whether the fluid is isothermal of uniform temperature in the tube, or whether we have now such a heat transfer condition, as soon as we can neglect this superimposed free convection, we find that the flow field, for instance, the velocity profile, is the same. There is only, again, one exception where this may not be, namely if the fluid properties which enter and which determine the flow depend strongly on temperature. Then we will not have this. A fluid in which the viscosity, which is quite important in the, to determine the flow, changes strongly with temperature is, for instance, an oil. Oil, you know that oils become very viscous at low temperature and become fairly thin at higher temperature. Then one finds in an oil, one would find the following. Such an oil. If I have a tube, and I have what we call laminar flow, a very nice straight flow through such a tube. At first, under isothermal conditions, no heat transfer, temperatures all uniform. Then we find, if we measure the velocity profile in this tube and plot it here in this way, that it is has a parabolic shape. So I mean, I plot at each radial position in the tube the velocity in this direction. If I have now a situation in which heat is transferred to the from the wall through the tube wall into the fluid, so this would be a Q at the wall. Then, as we said before, the parts near the wall of the fluid will become hotter, the center will stay colder. Now, the viscosity in the hotter part becomes smaller. This means the fluid can move easier. There is less shear in this outer portion, and as a consequence, the velocity profile would deform somewhere in this way. It becomes fuller. The opposite occurs if I cool. So if I take out heat through the tube wall, then the outer layers become very viscous and they don't want to move along, and the velocity profile would deform in this way. I mean, this may be exaggerated, but this is essentially the shape. So this again shows that under some conditions the heat transfer acts back and changes the velocity field. But if we forget about this, and if the variations of properties in our situation is not too strong, then this effect becomes small. And if we neglect it completely, so if we say we forget about the variation of properties with temperature, then one can exactly show from the equations describing the flow situation that the flow is completely independent of whether we have heat transfer or not heat transfer. This would, among other things, for instance, mean that if we have measured the pressure drop in a tube under uniform temperature conditions, no heat transfer, then we expect the same pressure drop to occur if we have now temperature variations in the over the cross sections of the tube. And this means generally all of the flow situations which we know, for instance, from isothermal flow conditions, actually those which we have discussed last year in the lecture on fluid mechanics, can be immediately applied to the situation which we discussed here. The flow is given whether there is heat transfer or not, and the heat transfer superimposes on the flow. So for this reason, I think it is quite good that we very briefly review the basic facts which we have discussed about flow, and especially those aspects which are important for the study or for the understanding of heat transfer. Yeah, we talked about forced flow. And the movement of a fluid is determined by the forces which act on a fluid. In order, we have the last in our lecture on fluid mechanics, we have considered this in such a way that we arbitrarily, in a similar way as we did it actually here in heat conduction, we consider a certain region in our flow field. We call this a control volume. And then we look at all of the forces which are applied, which act on the fluid in this control volume. And then Newton's equation has to apply to and has to describe then the movement which the fluid in this control volume undergoes. If we want to have local conditions, then exactly as here in heat conduction, we have to consider a very small, finally an infinitely small control volume. Now, if we have such a control volume, then we have two kinds of forces. We have forces of a very peculiar nature, really. We just, I think, stop wondering about these forces because we are used to it. Forces which somehow act on the difference, like gravitational attraction, which somehow acts on difference and which acts on all of the fluid particles within our control volume. We call such forces body forces. And then, in order to apply Newton's equation to this fluid in the control volume, we consider it, or we imagine it, isolated. So we move from the rest of the fluid, but in order to do so, we have now to introduce forces which act on the surface and which express the fact that the fluid surrounding this control volume somehow acts on the fluid in the control volume. And these forces we call surface forces. Now, I mentioned as an example gravity as a body force, and actually then this is the body force which causes, for instance, this free convection, which we have mentioned before. There are other body forces. If the fluid is electrically conducting, an electric field, magnetic field would exert such forces. In generally, if we have forced flow, then I have mentioned that the influence of gravity is usually small, and we will not consider any kind of conducting fluid, so we neglect, or we assume that no body forces are present, or if they are present, that the effect like gravity forces, that the effect is small. So then we have surface forces alone. And these we subdivide into two kinds of forces, forces which act in a normal direction on the surface, we call this pressure. Actually, pressure would be force per unit area, a pressure force. And then we have forces which act within the surface, which prevent the fluid from gliding, the fluid layers one over the other, or try to prevent it, and these are viscous forces. And Newton's equation tells us now that if either by pressure forces or by viscous forces, we have a net force acting on the fluid in our particle, then this fluid is accelerated. We also can say, and Newton's force would express this, the sum of pressure force plus viscous forces, all of the forces which act on the fluid particle, are mass times acceleration, or we also call this mass times acceleration the inertia force. We say the fluid has an inertia which opposes these forces as soon as it changes its velocity, as soon as it is either accelerated or decelerated. So essentially, our equation then is that the sum of all pressure forces, sum of and viscous forces, is equal to inertia force. Now, this means obviously here, if we have a specific situation, if we want to look at a specific situation, we can select the pressure force and the viscous forces arbitrarily, but then the inertia force is given, is set by this equation. Or we can do, actually, we can select any of these two forces. For instance, we can select the inertia force and the viscous force, and this determines the pressure force. And it is found that the type of flow which is caused by these forces depends on essentially on the ratio, not on the forces itself, but on the ratio of forces. And since we can select two forces freely, it depends on the ratio of two forces. For instance, on the ratio of inertia force to viscous force. And this ratio, because it's built by two physical quantities with the same dimension, must be dimensionless, and it is called, it's essentially what we call a Reynolds number, because Reynolds was the first to introduce. So, as soon as we want to know something about the behavior of a specific flow situation, the first question is always to find out what is a Reynolds number, and from this we can already say quite a bit. We can, for instance, we see, of course, that if the viscous forces are large compared to the inertia forces, the Reynolds number is small. Now, large viscous forces mean, for instance, large viscosity. If we have a fluid with large viscosity, something like viscous oil or honey, we have in general a small Reynolds number. We will see the next time that the Reynolds number does not depend on only on the nature of the fluid, but on other parameters as well. On the other hand, if we have large inertia forces, small viscous forces, then the Reynolds number becomes large. And this we have seen, and I will recapitulate this the next time once more, that this changes characteristics of the flow very strongly, whether we have a small or a large Reynolds number. Actually, in order to understand the meaning of the Reynolds number better, we have to introduce another term or another concept, the concept of similarity. And maybe there's just time to briefly mention what we understand by similarity. If we have a specific flow situation with a prescribed geometry, for instance, flow over a sphere with a certain diameter, flow which approaches the sphere here upstream with a uniform velocity, with a velocity v, then we have a certain flow field, a certain picture, the flows, the streamline. If I draw streamlines, for instance, we would find that the streamlines somehow move around the field. Now, the question which one asks then in order to get to the concept of similarity is the following. If I have a sphere with a different diameter, and if I have a flow with another velocity, and maybe even another fluid, is there a situation where, for instance, a streamline picture, which I could make visible by flow visualization, is similar in both cases? And what we understand by this, if we have now another sphere with half the diameter, say t dash, and if we use a different velocity, let's say half the velocity also, does there exist a situation in which, if we would draw a streamline picture around this sphere, this is exactly similar in shape to this one here? Or, in other words, for instance, if we measure the velocity at a certain location here, then if there is similarity, this means that the ratio of this velocity here to the upstream velocity in one situation is exactly the same as the ratio of the velocity here on a, as we say, geometrically similar point, where, let's say, this ratio of this distance here is again the same, let's say, no, the ratio of this distance to the diameter is the same as here, distance to diameter. And then if there is similarity, the ratio of these two velocities has to be the same as in this situation. And the answer is, and we will talk about this a little bit the next time, that this is a case when both have the same Reynolds number, where then the Reynolds number is based on prescribed characteristic values. In this case, it would be the diameter of the sphere times the upstream velocity divided by the kinematic viscosity, mu, of the fluid. So, if we find that the Reynolds number in this situation is the same, then this means that the two flows are completely similar. So, this shows really the importance of the Reynolds number. We know that if the Reynolds number, we can have various conditions. For instance, here's spheres with quite different diameters and quite different flow velocities and different liquids, different fluids, or even a liquid and a gas, as long as this ratio here is the same in both cases, the Reynolds number is the same, we know that the two flows are similar. And this, of course, is very important for heat transfer also. We will see that for this, then one can immediately, if one knows heat transfer on this sphere, one can immediately predict what the heat transfer on this sphere is. Okay, maybe this is vision closed today.